enjoying these new chairs?
Amen.
Amen.
You want to know a secret? I count heads from time to time. When we had the old grumpy chairs, we were averaging about 72. Since we've got the new chairs, we're averaging about 52. We're going to bring the old ones back. Y'all worship better and you do better with a backache and a buttache.
The one that's here tonight, don't
you? You got to get where you can feed
it. All right. Turn with me in your Bible to the book of Genesis, and we want to go to chapter 16. This is going to be our Mother's Day message. Mother's Day was yesterday, but we didn't worship yesterday in the Cowboy Church, and so we're catching Mother's Day today. I want to read all 16 verses of this chapter, 16th chapter of Genesis. This is the story of two women who needed a lot of help in the area of motherhood. They both had motherhood problems up to here. And what you're going to find in this passage of Scripture is that Almighty God met their need. This is Mother's Day and Women's Day, and I want you to hear this story because Almighty God is a God who understands our predicaments, and He heals them. Amen. Read with me, beginning in the first verse, Genesis 16. Now Sarah, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, and she had an Egyptian maidservant, a little slave, whose name was Hagar. And Sarah said to Abram, "Look now, the Lord has restrained me from bearing children. Please go in to my maid, perhaps I shall obtain children by her." And Abram heeded the voice of Sarah. Then Sarah, Abram's wife, took Hagar, her maid, the Egyptian, and gave her to her husband Abram to be his wife. And after Abram had dwelt for 10 years in the land of Canaan, when this happened, so he went in to Hagar. She conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, her mistress became despised in her eyes. So Sarah said to Abram, "My wrong, the wrong that is happening to me, is now on your head. I gave my maid into your embrace, and when she saw that she had conceived, I became despised in her eyes. And now, the Lord judge between you and me." So Abram said to Sarah, "Indeed, your maid is under your power. Do to her whatever you want to." So Sarah dealt harshly with her until the day came when Hagar fled from her presence. Now the angel of the Lord found her by a spring of water out in the wilderness, by the spring on the way to Shur. And he said, "Hagar, Sarah's slave maid, where have you come from and where are you going?" She said, "I'm fleeing from the presence of my mistress, Sarah." The angel of the Lord said to her, "Return to your mistress, submit yourself under her hand." And then the angel of the Lord said to her, "I will multiply your descendants exceedingly so that they shall not be counted for multitude." And the angel of the Lord said to her, "Behold, you are with a child, and you shall bear a son. And you shall call his name Ishmael, because the Lord has heard your affliction. And he shall be a wild man," literally a wild donkey of a man. "His name, his hand shall be against everybody, and everybody's hand shall be against him. And he shall dwell to the east of all of his brothers." So she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her, "You are the God who sees," or Ahai-Roi. For she said, "Here I also have seen him who sees me. Therefore, the well was called Beer Laharoi. Observe, it is still there between Kadesh and Bered. So Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram named the son whom Hagar bore Ishmael. Now Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael to Abram. You don't get very far in this text until you realize that here are two women who needed a friend. Things were not going well in their lives. One for purposes that she couldn't do anything about, and the other for purposes that she couldn't do anything about. I want you to understand carefully both of the women's stories before we look to see how God ministered to these women. Look at Sarah here. Sarah was a woman of God because Abram, her husband, was the covenant bearer in that day and in that time. God had come to Abram some years earlier than this, and he had promised him that he would be a great nation, that he would bless him, and that he would cause him to be a blessing to everybody who came in contact with him in a friendly way. And God said that he was going to bless Abraham, and that Abram would have so many children that you literally couldn't count them. It'd be like trying to count the stars in the night sky. And so Abram believed God, Genesis tells us in chapter 15, and it was reckoned to Abram for righteousness. He is the first member of the covenant family of faith, which is, of course, where we are here tonight. Part of covenant with God, a family of faith who believe His promises and who believe His word. So Sarah here is married to Abram, and that he is the first, the father of the faithful. She is first lady of the family of covenant faith. You look to Genesis 15:5. There's the promise clear as a bell. Children, offspring, descendants, more numerous than the stars in the sky. Now, there's only one big problem with all of this. And that was, they didn't have a baby yet. And they had waited, and they had waited, and they had waited. How old was Abram when Ishmael was born? Did you hear the story? 86. Well, Sarah was about 81 or 82. And no baby. And how am I going to be the firstborn, the first lady of the covenant family when there is no family? It's like being chief of a tribe when there are not any Indians. Or being a preacher in a house where there are no congregation. Nothing but empty chairs. Like I see over here, back there, back there. And so Sarah is getting desperate. How am I going to, you can hear her thoughts rolling in her head. How am I going to have a baby? I'm 82 years old, for God's sake. And so she looks around and she finds solutions in the way they do things outside of God's covenant out in the world. It was a big deal in those days if you didn't have any children, because that was where your social security came from. When you got old, if you didn't have children, you stood a good chance of falling into poverty or maybe starving or having nobody to take care of. And so what they would do in the non-covenant communities was they'd have multiple wives. One man, wife number one had no children, they'd get wife number two, and then wife number three, and four, and five, and so forth, and so on. And Sarah says, this covenant thing with God's not working. I know He promised, but I'm not too sure He's all that much of a God who keeps promises. We're going to run ahead of God, and we're going to do our own thing and create our own religious track. And she asked Abram, said, what if I put Hagar in your bedroom, and she has a baby we could claim that child. She could just be wife number two. Now, that is not what Genesis chapter 2 teaches about marriage. You know what that verse says, that great, great old verse on marriage over in Genesis 2? It says, a man, one man, shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, singular, not plural, and they two shall become one flesh. Ain't supposed to be no 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Yeah.
Well, Sarah says, you know, God's way doesn't always work. So we're going to help God be God. She's reaching way past her pay grade. And Abram, he said, okay, we'll try. We'll do anything. If mama ain't happy, nobody's happy. Abram knew that. So he goes along, like old Adam went along with Eve. One of the big sins of men is just going along with any darn thing that comes down the pipe.
Amen.
And not exercising any spiritual leadership in the home and family.
That's right.
So Abram, he covenant bearer of the covenant of God. Let's try the world's way and the world's system. See, we can't help God out a little bit. Well, the plan didn't work. Blew up in their face. And Sarah got mad at Abram. She tells Abram, she said, look at this. Look at this. I brought my slave girl into you. And now she's going to have a baby, and she looks down her nose at me. It's your fault. Abram didn't say it was your idea now. He knew better now. He was already between two rocks and a hard place. And so Sarah says, if you don't fix this, I'm going to go tell God. And he's going to come down here, and he's going to bring judgment on you. Abram says, for goodness sake, do what you want to. Brilliant leader that he was. And so, Sarah takes Hagar, who has gotten very uppity, and puts her to carrying out the slop jars and doing the dirty, dirty, dirty work. Demoted her down to Buck Private, where she had been first lady of service to the first lady of the manor. And Hagar took it for a week or two, but she couldn't take it much longer than that. She hit the road, and she left. And now things are in a dreadful mess. Who knows what to do? So that's Sarah's story. Now, what I'm suggesting to you is here is a woman who had problems in the area of motherhood, and she needed help. She tried to help herself and made a dog mess of it. Have you seen it? Have you ever tried it yourself? I remember making some dog messes in my own life.
Right.
Because I didn't like the way God did things. And I was going to use a worldly, non-covenant kind of operation. Now look at Hagar's story. She's a slave girl. She's an Egyptian. She doesn't know about Jehovah God. She doesn't know about the God who appeared to Abram and entered into covenant with him. She hears him talking about covenant, but she speaks a different language. She's an Egyptian. And Egypt's got all their gods. They got the Apis bull. That's a big old bull calf. You remember the 10 plagues of Egypt? Each one of those 10 plagues was directed at one of the Egyptian gods. Frogs. They worshiped frogs. One of my older brothers did that. He used to love to go get frog legs. He eat a bullfrog better to keep his mouth shut. When my brother Thamar was close to the mill pond in Weirgate, Texas, so that frog was going to get stuck and going to get fried. All kind of gods the Egyptians had. And so she was different. She wasn't one of the clan. And not only that, she was a slave. Somebody sold her. And Abraham bought her. That means that she had no agenda of her own. She couldn't make a decision. She couldn't have any future. All she could do was say, "Yes, ma'am," when Sarah spoke. And that was it. And there wasn't any hope for that ever changing either. And then one day she got a break. Her big, big chance in life. Sarah, in desperation, said, "Won't you spend the night with Abram and see if you can get pregnant and have a baby, and me and Abram will be the primary parents, and you'll be secondary parent, and you can be secondary wife." Well, that's better than slave. And so she's moving up in the world. She says, "All right, I can handle this." One night, bang, she's expecting. She's very fertile. She's a healthy person. Healthy girl. And here she is, wife number two, behind wife number one, who's 80-something years old and has no kids. And she finds herself in a horse race against an old three-legged horse. She says, "Shoot, I'm going to beat her. I'm going to take over this show." And her head begins to swell. And her importance in her own eyes begins to develop and enhance. And she is somebody big and important, she thinks. And then all of a sudden, she gets busted down to Buck Private because she's made Sarah mad. And she has to run, and she's out in the middle of the desert. And she doesn't know the way back to Egypt. The road is long and hard, and the water holes are few and far between. And she finds this one place where she can get a drink of water. And there she is. And guess who shows up? Almighty God. But now Hagar is in a mess. It didn't start off of her own making. But when she got her big break in life, she blew it.
Yeah.
She blew it. Have you ever seen it? Have you ever seen somebody win the lottery? And then 3 years later, they're $100,000 in debt. These two women made messes of their lives. And then God showed up, the Heavenly Father. I want you to know something. Your Heavenly Father is the friend you need.
Amen.
Look what he did. Look at the Heavenly Father in this passage of Scripture. Look what he did, first of all, for Sarah. The first thing he did to her was set her back on her covenant track of being first lady in the first family of faith that would eventually become God's covenant family in the earth. God was doing something in her life. She didn't know what it was. She had a baby 14 years after Ishmael was born. You know what God was trying to do with her? He made her wait. He was trying to show her that he was a God that can do anything.
Amen.
Even make a dead womb come back to life. Even make a dead soul come back to life. He's a God of resurrection, a God of life. And he was going to prove that to Abraham and Sarah so that they would know it and that would become part of the DNA of the covenant family down through the years. And we would know beyond shadow of doubt that when we live within the covenant of God, we will live and not die.
Amen.
But Sarah didn't know that then. She thought God was messing up. Well, God put her back on track. He says, "Sarah, you are the first lady of the first covenant family, and I want you to wait, and I'm going to give you a baby." And she said, and if you go to the next chapter, 17, 16, 17, 18 over there, they get a visit, and God said, "Next year at this time, Sarah, you're going to have a baby." And she broke down and laughed herself silly. Ha! 14 years after Ishmael was born. She's 100 years old by that time, or nearly in her 90s. Abram was 100 because he was 86 when Ishmael, 14 years later, he's 100 years old. 100 years old. You know what they named the boy when he was born? Isaac. You know what the Hebrew word Isaac means? Laughter. Downright funny. God's got a sense of humor. You don't think he hadn't got a sense of humor? You just picture Abraham and Sarah. He's 100 and she's 96, and they're looking for a community with a good school. But God set her back on her track of waiting. And that's what faith is, folks. Amen. Waiting for God to keep his promise. And unfaith is running ahead or lagging behind. Because you don't believe that God's going to keep his promise the way he said he is. Second thing he did for Sarah here is he gave her back her servant. And with a good attitude. Read verse 9 in our text. The angel told Hagar, return to your mistress and submit yourself under her hand. There's a big difference between someone who is submitting because it is forced on them, the way it was in Hagar's early servanthood, and someone who voluntarily submits themselves. Big difference. And so that's a better deal. God improved the situation in the day-to-day life that Sarah lived. He gave her back her servant, but he gave her the servant with a good attitude. Vicki and I had the same thing happen with our children. When they were younger, they submitted to our authority because they didn't have any choice. They got 17, 18, 19 years old. I couldn't stay awake all night and keep up with what devilment they were getting in. But it wasn't long. After a few years, they discovered that there was a devil in devilment. They came back to the faith with a whole different attitude. Boy, it was good. It was good. That's the way God does things. He made it better. Gave her, put her back on her faith track, and then he put her back in her everyday life track. So, Sarah, who had made a mess of things, thrown away her marriage, thrown away the marriage plan of God, one woman, one man, done everything she could do, and what did she wind up with? God steps in, and he puts her life back together better than it was before.
Yes.
Now, look what God did for Hagar. My goodness. She is, it looks like, in a mess. She's out in the middle of the desert. She's running for her life. She's expecting a baby. How would you like to be out in the middle of the desert expecting a baby? You don't even know where the next water hole is, and you're running on your 2 feet. No doctor, no nothing, no aspirin. And the Lord showed up. The Lord showed up. There's 2 things that God did for her that show up in this passage of Scripture. In the way she named. First of all, she named the well of water there. Beer, B-E-E-R, is the Hebrew word for well. Lahai Roy, the God who sees me and lets me see him. Now, I want you to know something. There are many, many people in this world who do not believe that anybody ever sees them. They feel like they're overlooked. They feel like nobody notices, nobody cares. And there's not a one of us in this room that can stand it when we get caught in that kind of a situation. You and I can't thrive, and we can't grow, and we can't become until we get seen or recognized by another person. Did you know that? Let me tell you where the best mirror in the world is that you need to look at so you can learn about yourself and who you are. The eyes of a true friend.
Amen.
Yes.
That's what builds us up. When we look at the eyes of a friend and that person sees us and their face smiles, that does something to us. Now, Hagar didn't ever have anybody look at her for much. You don't look at slaves. You don't see people like that. And Sarah, all she saw her was a solution to a problem that turned bad and became a worse problem. But I want you to know something. Hagar found this out, and it made all the difference in the world. God in heaven, the God who was making a covenant with Sarah and Abram, she wasn't a member of the covenant family. She wasn't a member of the church. She was out in the world. She was an Egyptian. The God of the covenant saw her and noticed her, cared for her anyway. Don't ever, ever make the mistake of trying to narrow down the grace of God so that it only fits within the walls of your church or your denomination. That is not true to the character and the nature and the heart of God.
Amen.
God saw her and let himself be seen by her. She says, I've seen God and it didn't kill me. And it changed the whole way she looked at life. If you know God is looking at you, you can stand anything. And if you think nobody's looking at you and nobody notices and God doesn't notice and God doesn't see you, just about anything and everything that comes along is going to knock you off your feet. So the first thing, God sees her and lets her know it and lets her see him as a caring, loving friend. And then a second thing has to do with the baby boy. So the angel says, you're going to have a boy, and his name needs to be Ishmael. And that's another Hebrew word. The ish part, ishmael, really means to hear. Shema is the Hebrew word for hear. Yishima is he hears. Put it in the third person singular. El on the end of it is God. Elohim. Ishmael is God who hears. God who listens. Now, if you read this passage of scripture carefully, and I did this, I said, Ishmael, God who hears. Okay, when did she pray? When did Hagar ever ask God? When did she address God? What did she say to God? There's not a sentence in the whole text where Hagar prayed, but God heard her anyway.
Amen.
Yeah.
Now, every time she called her child's name, she was reminding herself, there is a God in heaven, and he's dealing with Abraham and Sarah, but he loves me too because he hears me even when I don't pray. He hears the longing in your heart and in your soul. I want you to know something. There's prayers locked away in each one of us that we don't have faith enough to pray. There's things we need, but we're afraid we may not deserve to ask God to meet those needs. Well, God hears those longings and needs anyway. And he responds the same way he did to Hagar here. Every one of us ought to go buy a teddy bear and name him Ishmael. put him right in the middle of the bed, sleep with him every night. And remind ourselves there's a God who hears the longing in my soul. And it matters to him. Old James, half-brother of Jesus, puts it this way on the New Testament. He said, cast your cares on him because they are important to him. I feel sorry for anybody that gets bored with worshiping God. Lord, they don't know how stupid they are. Almighty God is the best friend Hagar and Sarah ever had. And Almighty God is the best friend you can ever have.
Amen.
There's just one or two little catches about his friendship. Number one, you got to wait for him to do his thing his way. You can't rush him. He's not going to operate on your time schedule.
That's right.
So you can just forget that.
Yeah.
He's doing things. He's got a plan for your life, and he's working you through the details of that plan. Even if you're not a member of the covenant family, he's got a plan for your life. Like he had for Hagar. And each step that he has worked into that plan is important, and you wait for him to work it out. And the waiting is how he reveals himself to you in his greatness and increases your faith and increases your security and increases your peace of mind and heart. So that's the first thing. If you're going to get the good out of God's friendship, you've got to wait on him and believe that he is up to something in your life and in the events and situations that come and go. And then a second thing is, you got to take his advice. You know where God advised Hagar? Go back and submit yourself to Sarah's authority. Now, you know, I'm going to tell you a secret. Hagar didn't want to do that. She didn't like Sarah anymore. She hated that old woman. She hated that old woman's husband. She did not want to go back and do that. And the angel of the Lord said, now, I've got more for you. If you'll do that, we're going to have a boy. He's going to be Ishmael, and he is going to be a fighting son of a gun. And everybody that deals with him, they're going to find out that they have bitten off a whole lot to try to chew. He's going to be a wild donkey of a man, and he'll kick and bite just like a wild donkey will. And he's going to be your security, and he's going to be your future. So you just let me work out the details here, but you go back and behave yourself and be a good servant in Abraham and Sarah's house. And she did. She did. You got to take his advice.
Yes.
She could have told God or told the angel of God, well, I'm not going to do that. I hate that old woman. I'm going back to Egypt. Which she probably never would have made. You can't get God's blessing until you take seriously his words and his advice and his instructions. And the Bible's full of them. That's what we gather here every Monday night. That's why we have something on the scriptures every Thursday night, every Friday night, every other time that we have a convocation of some sort on these premises to teach people how to listen to God and take his advice. If you do that, God's going to bless you and be the best friend. The best friend you could ever ask. Every now and then somebody figures this out in life experience and they write it for us in the words of a poem. A guy named Stephen Lorenzo wrote these words. Are you weary? Are you heavy hearted?
Yes.
Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Are you grieving over joys that have departed? Tell it to Jesus alone. Do the tears flow down your cheeks unbidden? Tell it to Jesus. Have you got sins that two men's eyes are hidden? Tell them to Jesus. Do you fear the gathering clouds of sorrow? Are you anxious about what will be tomorrow? Tell it to Jesus.
Yes.
He's listening. He cares. Are you troubled at the thought of dying? Tell it to Jesus. For Christ's coming kingdom, are you sighing? Feel like the world's going to hell in a handbasket? God can't make progress? Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that's well known or that's easy to know. You've no other such a friend or brother. Tell it to Jesus alone. May God give us grace to be shaped and molded by the power of His Word. Gracious Lord, we thank You for Your love, Your goodness. We thank